So if this kind of windings are able to be described, then we call that as uniform winding. So small n will be equal to capital N divided by n, right? I hope you understood this. So when you look at this helical path, when you try to project it on a paper, then how is it going to look like? It will be looking in the form of a cylinder, right? So it is going to look in the form of a cylinder. Then what is going to happen with respect to this is, see, observe. I'll show you my video. Concentrate. So if I take this as the solenoid's rod, the windings are like this. Okay. So I'm trying to say, I'm just removing my mouse. See. It is like this. I take a wire and wind it in this way. So are you able to observe this? Right. So when I project this winding onto my paper, onto the board, then how will it appear to us? It will be appearing in the form of a rectangle. So are you able to understand? So it is going to appear in the form of a rectangle such that at the topmost point, the current, see, according, when I see from this side, accordingly the current is going into the plane, and at the bottom of the winding it is coming out of the plane. So when I say into the plane, it is going to be like this. Into the plane, sorry, into the plane is into mark. When I say out of the plane, it is going to be a dot. Is there anyone having a doubt with this concept?
No, sir.
All right. So this,
sir,
yeah, tell me.
Sir, here we consider the surface as a rectangle. Why didn't we consider it as any other, like a cylinder or probably something like that?
No, cylinder. How will you? Cylinder is a three-dimensional shape. That is what I'm using again and again. When you project a cylinder onto a paper, that is, see, the pen I have in my hand is a cylinder. I keep it like this. Okay, I keep it on the wall. If I try to hit it, then what shape will it take? The cylinder. It is. You are able to visualize it. So actually, you don't. So what you mean by projection is dropping the perpendiculars from the endpoints. That is, if you have a cylinder like this, see, I'm drawing it, observe. If suppose I have a wall of it, then I ask you, how is the shadow of the cylinder going to look on the wall? Then what you're supposed to do is, from every point on this particular, the outer surface of the cylinder, you need to keep dropping the perpendiculars. So you need to keep dropping the perpendiculars such that when you look on the wall, no, on the wall you will have a shape of a rectangle. That is what is meant by projection. The same concept is what I'm applying it here.
Okay, sir.
Okay. So those who have the basics of engineering drawing will understand this. So what I'm saying is, this is the direction of current. So this is the direction of current. Right? So with this, the diagram part is over. Now what are we supposed to consider? We need to apply the Ampere circuit law. So for us to apply the Ampere circuit law, we need to consider a symmetrical shape about this charge, about this current distribution. So what is the symmetrical shape we can think of? We can think of a rectangle. I'm considering the rectangle in such a way that half portion is inside and the remaining half portion is outside. So what the other equations I've shown you here, we can have a look at it. Right. So half of the portion is inside and half of the portion is outside. If I take the total length of the Amperean loop as A and the width as B, then what I can say is the surface in the line integral of B dot dl is equal to mu naught into I enclosed. This is what is going to give us the Ampere's circuit law. You remember this, I hope. So the surface in the line integral of B dot dl is equal to mu naught into I enclosed. Now, how do I apply the concept of Ampere circuit law for this particular diagram? Where is it? Now, for this particular diagram, how am I supposed to apply? So, if I take this length to be B and this length to be A, okay, so how do I write this? I can write it as line integral of B dot dl from where to where? A to B plus the line integral of B dot dl from B to C plus the line integral of B dot dl from C to D plus the line integral of B dot dl from D to A. So this will be equal to mu naught into I enclosed. So I enclosed means what? The total current that is enclosed within this portion. Okay. So if I take this, What is the line integral of B dot dl from A to B? What is it going to be? So where is the magnetic field present? I told you one more important point with respect to this. What type of a solenoid is this? It is a long solenoid. What do you mean by long?
Length is more than thickness.
Length is more than the thickness. Due to which what will happen is what I told you.
Current outside will be zero. Current will be there only.
No. Inside. It's not about current.
Finite length.
It is the magnetic field outside will be zero.
Magnetic
field will be zero. So magnetic field is zero means where will it be zero? At the point CD it is going to be zero. So what is that I can ignore? I can ignore the point CD. This is gone. So CD is gone. What about DA and BC? If I take DA and BC, how are they with respect to the magnetic field? So that is also zero because they both are perpendicular. So the only magnetic field present is within the AB. So it is going to be B into DL from where to where of AB is equal to mu naught into, what should I write in the place of I enclosed? What should I write in the place of I enclosed? The number of turns that is present in that particular region multiplied with the amount of current. Can I write it like this? I should not write it as capital N into I because it is going to be N dash into I. Okay. So if I take this length to be B, then how many windings will be there between this point and this point? So how many windings are there between these two endpoints? Between the ends A and B, how many windings will be there? Can you tell me?
NB.
Sorry?
NB.
Which end?
N dash.
N dash is the number of windings that are present. No?
Small n B.
So small n is nothing but capital N by L.
N by L B.
So, but small n, I can also write it as N dash divided by B. Can I write it like this? So what I told N is nothing but the number of windings present in a particular length. So here by writing N by L, I'm trying to say that N number of windings are there in the length L. Then by writing N dash by B, I'm trying to write N dash windings are there in the length B. If you try to calculate the ratio will be a constant. That is what I meant by uniform windings. Right? So this will be equal to mu naught into N dash is nothing but small n into B into I. Can I write it like this? So B will come out, B into the line integral of BL. So what is the length of this AB? Length of AB is also B. So B into B, this and this will get cancelled. So B will be equal to mu naught into N into I. So this is going to be the value of the magnetic field inside the solenoid. And the magnetic field outside is going to be zero. Okay. Now how to visualize the direction? For this again, I'm switching on the video. Observe. So how is the direction I've taken? I've taken this as the rod. So it is going into the plane. So you can also hold your pen and check. So towards you can keep your finger like this. So the direction in which the finger is moving is the direction of the current. So I'm moving it from bottom to top, moving the forefinger from bottom to top. So when I go to the top, at this point, at the curvature, it'd be into the plane, right? So when I see from this side, how will the current appear to me? When I see it from this side, the current is going like this. When I see from this side, will the current appear clockwise or anti-clockwise with respect to me?
Clockwise.
You remember this clock rule? I told you, when the current is flowing in the clockwise direction, so when the current is flowing in the clockwise direction, what will happen? That particular pole will be behaving like a south pole. Do you remember this? Are you able to understand? So when I see from this end, that end is appearing, that end will behave like south pole. What about this end? When you see from this side, the same current, how will it appear?
Anti-clockwise.
Anti-clockwise. So anti-clockwise means which pole will it behave like?
North pole.
North pole. Right. So it will behave like a north pole. So what we are trying to say is, if you take the same solenoid, one end is behaving like a north pole, the other end, the left end of mine is behaving like a north pole, the right end is behaving like a south pole. Okay. So if this is treated like a permanent magnet, you know what is the direction of magnetic field due to a permanent magnet. So So what is the direction of magnetic field? If I take this as a bar magnet, it is always from
north to south.
North to south outside the magnet, and south to north inside the magnet. Because we know magnetic field always completes a loop. Unlike electric field will not complete a loop. Electric field is always from positive to negative charge. So positive charge is similar to north pole, negative charge is similar to a south pole. So what I can say from this is that a solenoid will behave similar to a bar magnet, except the fact that bar magnet will have permanent magnetism, whereas solenoid will have temporary magnetism. So what do you mean by temporary magnetism? It will have magnet for a short time. If you have only till that time, the current is passing within this conductor. Once you stop the current, the magnetic field will stop. That is why this is also called as a temporary magnet or an electromagnet. Okay. So when it is behaving like south pole and north pole, so for the solenoid that I've considered, if I take the current to be in the upward direction, if the current is going in this way, this is a very important point to observe. Questions will be asked on this. Then this end is going to behave like the south pole, this end will behave like the north pole. So if I create a similarity between a permanent magnet and a solenoid, what will be the direction of magnetic field for a solenoid within it?
South to north.
South to north. So this is going to be the direction of magnetic field. Are you able to understand? Whereas when you take it outside, it will be zero. I'm saying it zero because the curvature will be very big. When I take the length to be more, the curvature will be big, means close to the vicinity of the solenoid, the magnetic field is zero. Away from it, you will have slight amount of impact. So how you can test whether magnetic field is present or not? You can place a compass or you can drop some iron filings on it. So when you do that, you can observe that magnetic field is present. Is this concept clear? Sir, can you give the direction? Can you explain the direction of solenoid? Yeah. See, I'm trying to say the current is flowing like this. You need to check whether it is going to be a clockwise direction or anti-clockwise direction of whom, of the current. If the current is flowing in clockwise direction, that particular side will behave like a south pole. Okay. So that pole will behave like a south pole. And the one where it is flowing in the anti-clockwise direction will behave like a north pole. That is what I have taken. Okay. So if you guys are preparing for competitive exams, this kind of a question is mostly asked. There are many questions which are framed on this clock rule concept. So have a clarity of it. It will help you for your other exams as well. Okay. Darshini, I hope it is clear. So can we move on to the next concept? Write down the next heading. The next heading is called as a toroid. TOROID, it is either called as a toroid or you can also call it as a toroidal solenoid. So it is very simple and it is very much similar to the concept that we have discussed now. Okay, observe. So this is how a toroidal solenoid will look like. So can someone tell me what is the difference between this one and this one? So what difference is occurring?
The number of turns are higher.
No, that is because
the solenoid is
it looks like complete.
Solenoid is complete. There is no ending.
Circular.
That's it. That is the only thing. See, circular is the answer. Solenoid is going to have a length associated with it. When you talk about a toroid, if you take a solenoid and bend it in the form of a circular portion, then it is going to behave like a toroid. Okay, they both are almost similar. They have the same functionality, except the fact that solenoid is going to be linear and toroid is going to be circular. That is the only difference. So when I try to draw this in the form of a circle, so it has some thickness associated. Let's say the part around which the windings are made is having certain thickness associated. Now I'm taking the toroid to be like this. I hope you are able to understand this. So let's say there is a small opening. The opening is created only to pass some current through this particular device. So let's say the current is flowing in it. So as long as the current is flowing in it, it is going to behave like a magnet, right? So we need to find what is going to be the magnetic field due to this toroid inside the toroid. That is, or I'll put it like this, in the inner radius in between the toroid and outer. So this is what we are going to find. Okay. Now for this, how I'm going to define this, I'll show you the diagram that is given in the textbook. So this is the one, the toroid. It is going to look like this. I hope you are able to visualize how it is going to look like. So if you observe, there are three points. We are going to find the magnetic field at point P. We'll find what is the magnetic field at point Q, that is outside. And we are going to find what is the magnetic field in between also. So if you observe, similar to a solenoid, the magnetic field is going to exist only, magnetic field is going to exist only within the toroid. Okay. So when you try to draw the similar kind of a diagram, that is, I have the outer radii, I have the inner radii. Okay, let me say this radius is R or R1, and let me say this radius is R2. So if I take the average of these two, ignoring the thickness, I'm assuming the thickness to be very small, then let me say this radius is going to be R. Okay, so how is the current at the outer portion going to be? How is the current at the outer portion going to be? Look at the way they have considered the direction of current. You're able to see this? I've zoomed it enough. So you're able to see the direction of current. The direction of current is in the downward direction. So downward direction means at the topmost point, is the current coming towards you or away from you?
Towards
us, right? So towards us means you put a dot. Away from you, you're going to put an into mark. That is what they have done here. Right? So what you're supposed to do is you need to concentrate on the black color parts. The black color parts are the inner and the outer radii of the toroid. Okay, the blue color things that they have considered are the Amperian loops. So don't look at that and get confused. Okay. So observe. So at the outermost point, the current is towards us. At the inner point, the current is away from us. So this is how I'm taking. I hope there is no doubt in this. Again, I'm going to define it like this. Let capital N be the number of turns. Then N be the number of turns per unit length. Okay. Then small n will be equal to how much? Capital N divided by 2 pi into R. Can I take it like this? Right, because this is going to be the length of the toroid. It is nothing but the circumference of it, right? Now what I'm going to do is, if I take this point as P inside, if I take this point as Q outside, see, when I ignore the thickness, again, it is going to behave like a long solenoid. So when that is happening, what would be the magnetic field on either side of it? What would be the magnetic field on either side of the shaded portion? So what is happening with respect to a solenoid? So for a solenoid, I told you, right? What did I say? Magnetic field outside it is zero. So here also the magnetic field is zero. Here also the magnetic field is zero. 1 minute, I think there is some delay. See. Here also the magnetic field will be zero. Here also the magnetic field is zero. In a similar way, what do you think will happen with respect to a toroid? Are you guys able to hear me?
Yes, sir.
So what the screen is lagging.
Yeah, it is lagging. I'm just checking it. sometimes it happens. Internet issues. Right. So just give me a second. So now you are able to see. I'm asking what will be the magnetic field at point P and point Q?
Point Q, zero.
Point P?
Zero.
Magnetic field at point P and point Q both will be zero because they are considered as the outer portion of the solenoid. So here what I'm trying to conclude is a toroid is nothing but a solenoid taken. Your internet connection is unstable. Let's see. So the magnetic field at point P and point Q is going to be equal to zero. So where is the only place where the magnetic field is present? It is present only within the toroid. So what I'm going to do here is, if you take a toroid like this, then I will consider an Amperian loop within it. I'm going to consider an Amperian loop within it of radius R. Okay. Then I'm going to apply the Ampere circuit law. What does the Ampere circuit law state? The line integral of B dot dl will be equal to mu naught into I enclosed. Right? So the loop integral of B dot dl will be equal to mu into I enclosed. So B into the line integral of dl will be equal to mu naught into I enclosed. B into, what is the value of line integral of dl? So if I add up all 2 pi into small r is equal to mu naught into, what are the total number of turns that are included in it? Since I'm considering the whole length of the solenoid, the total length I've considered it to be n. So n into I will be the answer. So what will you have? B is equal to mu naught ni divided by 2 pi into r. But what is n divided by 2 pi r? Small n. Right? So B is equal to mu naught into ni. I hope there is no latency, no? It is better, right?
Yes, sir.
So B will be equal to mu naught into n into I. So this was the same result that was observed for a solenoid as well. Right? The same result is being observed here also. That's what I told you. Their functionality is the same, only fact is their shapes are different. So you can make a note of it. This is the portion which is the derivation of this toroid. The remaining portion was only your only the theory part which I explained. So once you write this, you can go through your textbook, you'll understand it.
Sir?
Yeah, tell me.
So why is the magnetic field at B and Q zero?
Because of the thickness, same thing. No? What happened for a solenoid?
Magnetic field outside was
zero, right? So when I bend the same thing in the sea, magnetic field outside means if I take this point as Q, if I take this point as P, magnetic field at P is zero, magnetic field at Q is also zero, right? This is for a solenoid. This point is clear?
Yes, sir.
If I bend the same solenoid in the form of a circle, where will the point P be? The point P is going to be here, the point Q is going to be here. Let me say this point is S. So if I take this point as S, so with respect to this toroid, which is nothing but a circular solenoid, can I say P is an outside point? Can I say Q is an outside point? And S is going to be the internal point. So whatever happened for a solenoid will happen here also. That is why I told magnetic field at Q and magnetic field at P is also zero. Is it clear now?
So basically the toroid is basically
a solenoid in the form
something like a ring, a hollow.
That's it. No, you saw, no? I showed you the diagram also. So this is what is a, this is what a toroid is.
Okay, sir. Got it, sir.
Yeah.
I didn't see the hollow.
No problem. Others clear? These two are the slightly tricky concepts in this. The other parts are easy. So I hope you have finished it.
Sir,
tell me. Yeah.
Sir, so we consider the, since the external part it is zero, so we just consider the inner term.
That is the reason only why we are saying only the inner part will have the magnetic field.
Magnetic field. Sir, and how did we get Ni, sir?
The number of turns, if correct.
Because the I enclosed.
If,
okay.
If you take the windings like this, this is considered as one winding. This is considered as another winding. Okay, so like this, if you add up, there will be n windings. Those n windings are contributing with the same current I. It is like all those windings, it is like one winding is connected to the other in series.
Yes, sir. Okay. So they,
okay. Here. So there is a small problem that is given. We'll try to do that and then we'll go to the next concept. So the question is, a solenoid of length 0.5 meter has a radius of 1 centimeter and made up of 500 turns. So what are all the values given? So length is 0.5 meter. I'm writing it here itself. Observe, 0.5 meter. The radius of the solenoid is 1 centimeter. Okay. And it is made up of 500 turns. So capital N is 500. Okay, number of turns is capital N. It carries a current of 5 ampere. What is the magnitude of the magnetic field inside the solenoid? So what is the formula? B is equal to?
Mu naught Ni.
Mu naught Ni. So mu naught is how much? 4 pi into 10 power minus 7 into the number of turns per unit length. Number of turns is 500 divided by the total length is half a meter. Into what is going to be the current? Current is 5 ampere. So you multiply everything, you're going to get the answer. Those many Tesla is the answer. So it is going to be 4 pi into 10 power minus 7 into 1000 into 5. So 5000 into 4 pi into 10 power minus 7 Tesla. So 5000 into, I can split it and write it as 2 pi. So 2 into 2 pi. 5000 into 2 is 10,000 into 2 pi into 10 power minus 7 Tesla. So 10,000 is 10 power 5 into 2 pi is 6.28 into 10 power minus 7 Tesla. So answer will be 6.28 into 10 power minus 10 power 4 rather. 10 power 4, so it will be 10 power minus 3 Tesla. Right, it's a very simple problem. So once you're done with this, we'll go to the next concept. So we'll write down the next one. So write down the heading as, with this, the Ampere circuitor law's application as well. For example, when we saw, when we saw Gauss law, we saw three applications, right? What were the three applications? We found out what is the electric field due to a straight current carrying wire. Then we saw for a planar sheet and we saw for a spherical shell. In a similar way, when you see for Ampere circuitor law, we apply the Ampere circuitor law for three cases. One was for infinitely long wire. You got the answer as mu naught I divided by 2 pi r or 2 pi into d. I hope you remember this. Similarly, for a solenoid and for a toroid. So for these two, you got the value as mu naught into n into I. So these are all the applications of Ampere circuitor law. Now we are moving on to the next concept, that is, what will happen when you place a current carrying loop in a magnetic field? Okay. So this is what you need to have a clarity of. So previously, we discussed one concept. Current carrying conductor in magnetic field. Do you people remember this? So you have a magnetic field. In this magnetic field, when I place a current carrying conductor of length L, what will happen to it? What will happen?
It
will experience a force of how much value? I never used torque till now. It will experience a force of I into L vector cross B vector, or you will have it at BIL, say say it as sine theta. It experiences a force of B into I into L sine theta, right? So here a small word will change the whole context. Observe, I use the word current carrying conductor. Okay, the next is they are using a current loop. So try to understand, conductor is an open one. Okay, whereas a current loop is always a closed one. I'm repeating it again. When they use the word current carrying conductor, they are trying to speak about an open circuit. Okay, open. Rather than using the word open circuit, I can talk about an open system. Whereas when they use the word current carrying loop, then they are trying to talk about a closed portion. So what happens here is we need to understand this term. So torque on current carrying loop or magnetic dipole is the word they are using. Now let's revisit the first chapter. In the first chapter, when you have electric field, right? When you have electric field, in an electric field, if you place an electric dipole, what happened to it?
Experience the torque.
Torque of how much value?
P sine theta,
or you can write it as P vector cross E vector, right? But if the same question I put it like this, in the same electric field, instead of having a dipole, had you had a positive charge, what would have happened?
It experiences
a force of QE. So here also, so I hope you are able to understand this point, right? So when an isolated charge is placed in electric field, it experiences force. Whereas when an electric dipole is placed in electric field, it experiences torque. So what are these two effects? Force always causes what type of motion?
Translative
motion. And torque is responsible for?
Rotational.
So this is the simple difference we need to understand. Okay. The same thing is being applied here also. So instead of charge, I'm calling it as a conductor. Okay. Similarly, instead of a magnetic dipole, I'm calling it as a current carrying loop, because we know this concept. Current carrying loop acts as a magnetic dipole. I told you. Current carrying loop acts as a magnetic dipole. Can someone tell me what is the reason for it? When I take a current carrying loop, the current is going to be in a loop. If I take the current to be I like this. So when I am able to see the current, how is it appearing with respect to me? Is it clockwise or anti-clockwise?
Clockwise,
right? Whereas when the same person is on the other side of the paper and he is able to observe the same current, for him, with respect to him, it will be anti-clockwise. We know that clockwise currents will produce south pole and the anti-clockwise current will produce the north pole. Means for the same current carrying loop, when you see it from either side of it, it has both north and the south pole present on it. That is why current carrying loop, please underline this word, current carrying loop always acts as a magnetic dipole. So from this, you can understand one thing. When you place a current carrying loop in external magnetic field, what will happen? You can start experiencing torque. Am I clear with this? You can always relate this concept to electric field. Whatever happens in the case of an electric field, the same thing will happen in the case of a magnetic field almost all the times. Right? So here the concept is, we are going to have an external magnetic field. I will show you the diagram itself. See, observe it. So it is in page number 157 in your textbook. So how will you produce an external magnetic field? By placing two permanent magnets. So you have two permanent magnets. Within that permanent magnet, what have you placed? You have placed a small current carrying loop. Forget about these things at all. Forget about these things. Imagine this as a current carrying loop as of. So this, in this current carrying loop, what will happen? Once the current is going, we know that the current will flow from positive to the negative charge. So when the current is going in this direction, it will enter here, and current obviously will tend to flow in this direction. I hope you are able to visualize this. Right? So the current in the path BC will flow in the rightward direction. Current in the path CD will flow in the downward direction, that is towards me, towards us. And here it is going to be like this, and it will complete the loop and again come back to its, come back to the negative plate. I hope you are able to visualize it. So from A to B, the current is flowing from A to B, from B to C, C to D, and D to A again. So that is how the loop is completed. Now if I break it, if I break and observe, can I say AB is like a current carrying conductor placed in the magnetic field? Similarly, BC will be a current carrying conductor which is placed in the magnetic field. Similarly, CD will be a current carrying conductor, and DA will be another current carrying conductor which is placed in the magnetic field. So I'm trying to break the system into four different parts. For you to visualize it better, I'm drawing the diagram in this way. A, B, C. Okay, I'll take it in the way they have taken. So A, B, C, and D. If this is the current, I, and I. So let's say this side's length is A, and this side the length is B, and this particular current carrying conductor is placed in an external magnetic field like this. Let the external magnetic field's value be capital B. Is it clear till this step? So if I take this as the first, second, third, and fourth, what will happen to the first conductor individually? If I assume that AB alone is placed in the magnetic field, what would have happened to AB? Is AB a current carrying conductor or a loop?
Conductor.
So conductor will experience
magnetic force.
Magnetic force. So AB will experience a force of how much value? F vector will be equal to I into L vector cross B vector, or I can write it as I into L into B sine theta. Sine theta n cap will come actually. If I write only the magnitude, it will be BIL into sine theta. So what is the magnetic field in which it is present? It is B. The current that is flowing through the conductor is I. So what is the length of the portion AB?
B.
Small b. Sine of, what is the angle between the length and the magnetic field? Length is
perpendicular.
Perpendicular. So it will be sine 90 degrees. So it will be BI into B, but in which direction?
Upward direction.
Sorry?
Direction.
Upwards.
Upward. So how do you find the direction of force experienced by current carrying conductor?
Fleming's right.
No, right hand, left hand. Apply and tell me. Apply and tell me. Or else you can use vectors also. I taught you another method. I into L vector plus B vector. L vector is in which direction?
J cap.
J cap. B vector is in the direction of?
I cap.
I cap.
J cross I is what?
Minus K. K cap.
So it will experience a force away from us. So it will be into the plane. So the force at this point will be into the plane. Let me say that value is F. Now what will be the force experienced by BC? There is the force experienced by AB. What is the force experienced by BC?
Zero.
Zero.
Reason?
Sine zero.
Parallel. Very good. So similarly, what else will be zero?
AD.
DA.
If DA will also be zero because angle is 180 degrees. Okay. Now what about FCD? What will be the value for FCD? That will be
A cap.
I into, no, I want the value magnitude. I into, or I will write it as B into I into L sine theta. So B is how much? B only, I is I only, L is small b into sine 90 degrees. That will be equal to B into I into B. But what is the difference? Here, if AB vector is in the direction of minus K cap, if CD vector is in the direction of K cap. I hope there is no one having a doubt with the directions. I hope no one is having a doubt with the directions.
No, sir.
No, right? So if I ask you what is the total force experienced by the system? F total.
Zero.
F total is zero. But if I ask you what is the total So listen. If this is how, let's say, if this is how the dipole is placed out, okay? If this is how the dipole is placed, this is AB, BC, CD, and DA. And this is the direction of electric field, sorry, magnetic field. So BC is experiencing, sorry, AB is experiencing force in which direction? It is towards you, it is like this. It is, so this conductor will have the tendency to move in this way. It will have a tendency to move in this way. Similarly, this side conductor has a tendency to move towards me. So this conductor will move towards you, this conductor will move towards me. But what will happen to this portion and this portion? These two portions will make these two get fixed. As a result of which, when this is trying to revolve, move, the whole system will start revolving like this. So you able to understand? It starts revolving. So when it is revolving, obviously what should be present for something to revolve? Obviously, the torque should be present. So one common mistake that happens is just because the total force is zero, many people think that the total torque acting on the system is also zero. Okay. So the torque is what? That is what we need to calculate. And the next important point is, whenever there is a question which is based on torque, the immediate question you are supposed to ask is, the system is rotating about which axis of rotation? Okay. So it is rotating about which axis? For example, if I take this mobile phone, if this is revolving like this, then where is the axis of it? So where is going to be the axis of it? The axis will be somewhere over here. Okay. So I'm drawing it again. Listen, I'm drawing it on the paper. Observe. So when I take a current carrying loop like this, so this will be the axis of rotation about which it is tending to rotate. Right? So this is AOR, axis of rotation. Now the force is into the plane. And what is this distance? Can you tell me what this distance is?
A by 2.
It is A by 2. Similarly, here the force is outward. Then what is this distance? This distance is also A by 2.
A by 2.
Right. So what is the torque experienced by the first conductor? So what is the formula for torque? Torque is force into perpendicular distance. So what is the force acting on the conductor that we have already found? That is B into I into B. Into what is the perpendicular distance across which it is acting?
A by 2.
A by 2.
A by 2. Right. Similarly, what is the value of torque 2? This is also B into I into B into A by 2. But what are the directions? That is what we need to tell. So how to find the direction of torque? So torque is given as R vector cross F vector. This I have told you in the first chapter itself. Like, how do you find the direction of R vector cross F vector? So R vector is always taken in the direction from the point of application of force to the axis of rotation. So here A by 2 is in which direction?
I cap.
I cap with respect to whom? With respect to left side conductor or right side conductor?
Left side conductor.
So with respect to, so I'm calculating for direction of torque 1. I will write it as A by 2 into I cap cross. What is the direction of F vector? B into I into B, what is the direction? You already found
minus
it.
K cap.
Minus K cap. So what is I cross minus K?
J cap.
So I, J, K. So I cross K is minus J. So minus of minus J will be plus J. So it will be like this. A by 2 into B I into B. Then I cross K will be J cap. So here, torque experienced by the first conductor will be in the direction of J cap. Similarly, what will be the torque experienced by the second conductor using the same logic? Tell me.
J cap.
It is A by 2 into I'm using R vector cross F vector, A by 2 into. So with respect to the second condition, very good, it is minus I cap cross F is R cross F. So it is B I into B. We have already calculated this K cap. So A by 2 into B I into B minus I cap cross K cap will also be J cap. So it is again going to be B I into A B divided by 2 in the direction of J cap. So what can we conclude from this? Both the torques are going to act
same direction.
Same direction. So what is going to be the net torque acting on the system? So the net torque will be equal to torque 1 vector plus torque 2 vector. So that will be B into I into AB divided by 2 in the direction of J cap plus B into I into AB divided by 2 in the direction of J cap. So what will get added? So BI AB by 2 by 2, half plus half is going to be 1. So this is J cap. So this I can write it as B into I into AB J cap. So what is AB? According to the way I have considered the loop, what does AB represent?
Area.
Right. So it is going to be the area. So I can write it as B into I into area into J. Okay. If the number of turns in the loop are capital N, then what would have been the torque? It would have been NIAB, right? So the other way of writing this is there any doubt till here? No, right?
No, sir.
This I into A or NI into A is what is called as the magnetic dipole moment. It's called as the magnetic dipole moment. So torque is also written as MB, or to be more specific, the torque is actually written as MB sin theta. Here we took it as MB because for derivation purpose, I have taken the value to be theta to be 90 degrees. So the actual formula for torque experienced by a magnetic dipole will be MB sin theta. But in the same thing, when you write it in the vector form, it is written as M vector cross B vector. So is it not similar to P vector cross E vector? Instead of P you have M, instead of B you have E. So are you able to understand this?
Yes, sir.
Yes. So just copy this. So I copy, if there is any doubt, let me know.
Can you scroll down?
Thank you. So are you guys done? So the same thing I guess I told you in the vector form also, it is written as n vector plus b vector. So what are all the expressions for torque are? Torque is equal to NIAB sin theta. So torque is also written as MB sin theta, or torque in the vector form is written as M vector cross B. Okay, so these are all the points to be kept in your mind. There are two simple subtopics that are left out. Okay, one is a moving coil galvanometer and conversion of a galvanometer into an ammeter and voltmeter. And the last part that is left out is a device called a cyclotron. Okay, so before we go to that, we can try out some problems so that you apply all the formula. So look at 4.1. So there is a circular coil of wire consisting of 100 turns, each of radius 8 cm, carries a current of 0.4 ampere. What is the magnitude of the field at the center of the coil? So what is the formula for it?
Mu not Ni.
Mu not Ni? That is for a solenoid. There is a circular coil. Again, confusion started. See, toroid is different from a circular coil. Circular coil means the one which we discussed in the beginning base. B is equal to mu naught n I a square divided by 2 into a square plus x square.
Oh.
Remember this?
Oh, okay.
Now they are asking at the center, you need to put x is equal to 0. So here how to find this? When they say circular coil, so circular coil means this thing. Coil is always a magnetic dipole. So when I put x is equal to 0, you remember mu is equal to, b is equal to mu naught ni divided by 2 into a. You remember this formula? So what is the value of capital N? It is 100. Each of radius 8 cm carries a current of 0.4 ampere. So I is equal to 0.4 ampere. And B will be equal to mu naught. Mu naught can be written as 4 pi into 10 power minus 7. Okay. Into capital N is 100 into the number of turns is 0.4 divided by 2 into, in the place of radius, I can write it as 8 centimeters. So 8 into 10 power minus 2 meter. So calculate this value, that will give you the answer. Calculation part, I'm leaving it to you. Let's not waste time. So who's the third one? So how to do the third one?
U not I by 2
pi a.
So 4.3. Mu naught I, yes, formula is right. B is equal to mu naught I divided by 2 pi a, that's right. B is equal to mu naught I divided by 2 pi a, that is 100% right. But what is the direction? So here you need to visualize it, observe. See, observe, I'm showing you the diagram. So if you take this as the horizontal plane, so let's say you keep a pen on your table. Let's say you are placing a pen in such a way that the pen is in the direction in which you are seeing, like this. It is straight like this. So this is the pen, this is the conductor which is said to be on a horizontal plane. So how is the current flowing in it? Current is flowing from north to south direction. So when you take it like this, so here you cannot say minus j cap, it is minus k cap actually. So this is north, this is south, this is east, and this is west. I'm repeating it again. What you do is you have a book in front of you. On the book, you place your pen. Okay. On the book, you place the pen in such a way that the cap is away from you. Place it in this way so that you can visualize it better. So that the cap is away from you. The cap portion is taken as the north. The other portion of the other part of the pen is taken as south. Okay. On the right of this, on the right of the pen is taken as east, on the left of the pen is taken as west. So how is the current flowing? It is from north to south. So north to south, according to this scenario, is it towards you or away from you?
Towards you.
Towards you. And east is on the right of this. Right? East is on the right of this. Now apply the cross product of vectors and tell me what is the answer.
A cap.
It is J cap. So J cap in this scenario.
Plus K cap.
No. How will you get K cap? So the pen is like this. No. Current is flowing towards you. Anything towards you is what I told. Anything towards you is plus K cap. So how do you find the direction of magnetic field? Direction of magnetic field. I told you to do a rough work using the cross product. What is that? I into dl vector cross r vector will give you the direction of magnetic field. What is the direction of current in this case? Current in this case is towards you. Towards you is k cap cross. With respect to this, what is this rightward direction?
I cap.
I cap. K cross I. What is k cross I? It is j cap. So j cap means when the pin is placed on the horizontal plane at this point, on the right of it, at a distance of whatever distance you want, at that point, the magnetic field will be in the upward direction. Okay, here the magnetic field will be in the upward direction. So the answer you are supposed to write is, you should not write it as J cap and K cap. You should write it saying that at the point 5 centimeters in the east of the particular scenario, the magnetic field will be in the vertically upward direction. So it will be in the vertically upward direction. Are you able to understand this? Is there anyone having a doubt with this? Anyone with a doubt?
No,
sir. Okay. So this is about 4.3. In a similar way, can you people try 4.4? So in this chapter, the most important part is not applying the formula, it is about the directions. So be careful. So same similar type of concepts will come in the sixth chapter also. You have to do the reverse scenario. Unless you understand this, I cannot teach that part. So please have clarity. Whatever is not clear, please get it clarified. Next. A horizontal overhead power line carries a current of 90 ampere in the east to west direction. So there is an overhead cable. The current is flowing from east to west direction. What is the magnitude and direction of the magnetic field due to the current 1.5 meter below the line? So if this is east and this is west, you can take this as north and towards me as south. So if I keep it like this, I'm placing it like this. See, north, So the tip of my right finger is north, south. The tip of this finger is east and west. So north, south, east, west, I'm treating it like this. It is like this. Visualize it in this way. Current is flowing in this direction. It is flowing from east to west. And where is the point considered? The point is considered 1.5 meters below the line. It is somewhere over here. So what is going to be the direction of magnetic field at this point? Can people find it out?
Minus I cap.
This minus?
I cap.
How will it be minus?
J cap.
J cap.
Minus J cap.
Is minus J cap. Because I is already current's direction.
Is it K cap?
It should be. K cap means what is the direction according to the way we have considered?
Towards, sir.
Towards?
Viewer.
Towards S means what? Is it north, north or south?
South.
You're able to understand how you're supposed to take the northeast west south direction. So if this is over, 4.4 is over, you can go to 4.6. So 4.6, what is the question? There is a 3 cm wire carrying a current of 10 ampere placed inside a solenoid. Yeah, tell me.
Sorry, what is the direction
of
4.4?
It is in the south direction, from the north to south.
Oh, okay. No, like in terms of vector, like was it J cap?
It is minus K cap.
Okay.
Minus, sorry, not minus K cap. It is K cap. K cap is towards you. Guys, you got K cap on you, no?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. K cap is towards you. It is south direction. So 4.6. Let's see. There is a 3 cm wire carrying a current of 10 ampere, which is placed inside a solenoid perpendicular to its axis. The magnetic field inside the solenoid is given to be 0.27 tesla. What is the magnetic force of the wire? So you have to visualize this first. So you have a solenoid like this. Solenoid means, I hope you are able to imagine this. You have windings. So let's say this is a solenoid. Then this pen is going to give me the axis of the solenoid. I hope that is clear. Now what is it you have? You have a solenoid which is already generating a magnetic field of how much value? 0.27 tesla. So there is an external magnetic field present. In this external magnetic field, you have placed a 3 cm wire and carrying a current of 10 ampere. How did you place it? You placed it the perpendicular. It is like this. Okay. So when you place it perpendicular, when a current carrying conductor is placed in an external magnetic field, what will happen to it? It starts experiencing a force. It's experiencing a force of B into I into L into sine theta. What is the magnetic force of the wire? Here you need not tell about the direction, but for our practice, we will do it. So F is equal to B is 0.27. What is the current carrying conductor length? 3 into 10 power minus 2 meter into the current that it is carrying is 10 ampere. Sine of how much is the angle? You know that for a solenoid, the magnetic field is present only along the axis. So the magnetic field is along this direction and this is along perpendicular direction. So what is the angle between them? Sine?
90.
So what will be the answer? It will be 0.81 into 10 power minus 1. Right? No mistake, no? These many tesla. So 0.81 into 10 power minus 1 tesla or 0.081 tesla. I hope this is clear. Right. So in the same question, let's say they're asking you to find the direction of the magnetic force. What will be the direction?
Minus theta.
The answer will be, is it minus theta? You have to be more specific. Minus k cap is wrong.
K cap.
For that matter, if you can.
How was the wire wounded, sir? Actually.
That is what. That is the question I was expecting. See, they have mentioned nothing, right? They have mentioned nothing about the direction. They have told you only the magnitude of the field, that is 0.27 Tesla. Did they mention that this is in the rightward direction or leftward direction? So the question has insufficient data for us to find the direction. You need to understand. So in this case, you cannot find it. That is why they have asked you, what is the magnetic force that is present? Means here, if you report the magnitude alone, that is more than sufficient. Whereas in the other questions, you see, they have clearly specified, give the magnitude and direction of B vector, because they have already mentioned the directions of current and the points. That is why it was easy for us. Here you cannot find. I hope it's clear. Right. So don't do 4.8 now. I will teach you later. Now you can do 4.9. Do 4.9. Sorry, you can actually do 4.8 also. Okay, once you finish 4.9, do it. So what does 4.9 say? There is a square coil. Okay. So wherever you see the word coil, what should come to your mind? All current carrying coils are magnetic. They are dipole. That word should come to your mind. So when a magnetic dipole is placed in external magnetic field, torque is produced. So add this in your mind. So there is a square coil of size 10 cm which is consisting of 20 turns and carries a current of 12 ampere. The coil is suspended vertically and the normal to the plane of the coil makes an angle 30 degrees with the direction of the uniform horizontal magnetic field of 0.8 Tesla. What is the magnitude of the torque experienced by the coil? So if you want to visualize it, there is a square coil. So for the square coil, how will the normal be? It will be like this. Normal means perpendicular. So there is a magnetic field in this direction. So the magnetic field with respect to the normal is making an angle of 30 degrees. So there is a normal. From the normal, this angle is 30 degrees. Now we need to find the torque experienced by this. So what is the formula for torque, guys?
NBIA.
It's NIAB. You forgot something.
Sin theta.
J cap.
No, J cap. If I don't put a vector symbol here, no J cap. See, J cap, again, don't get confused. That J cap was only for that derivation. If I consider the coil in different orientations, it will be different. That J cap is only to explain that it will be perpendicular. Don't fix that J cap in your mind. That is not there in the formula. So torque is equal to NIAB into sin theta. So what are the number of turns that are given?
20.
I?
12.
Then magnetic field, 0.8 Tesla. Theta?
30.
So when I told you the formula NA B sin theta, you didn't ask, you didn't tell me what theta is. What is theta? Theta is the angle between
conductor and magnetic.
Conductor will not have, how will you say conductor? Conductor does not have, conductor is a loop, right? You cannot measure the angle between a loop and then a line. Angle is generally measured between two lines.
Normal to the plane and uniform horizontal.
See, I can raise a question saying that 30 degrees or 60 degrees. So what is the right answer? 30 or 60? For their complementary angles. Because how is the diagram? It is like this. You have a square plate. There is a normal. They told the angle between the normal and the magnetic field is 30 degrees. So this angle is 30. Right? With the vertical, it is 30 degrees this side. So how much will this angle be? How much will this angle be?
60 degrees.
The 60 degrees. Which one should I take? Should I take 30 degrees or 60 degrees? It is the angle between what?
60.
You should actually take 30 only.
Angle between the conductor plane.
It is the angle between the normal and the conductor, normal and the magnetic field only. The reason I ask this question is you might have you will definitely have a tendency to make a mistake. So the angle is always taken between the magnetic dipole moment. Okay, angle is taken between magnetic dipole moment and the magnetic field. It is taken between M vector cross B vector. And M vector is always, make a note of it, M vector is always in the direction of aerial vector. In the direction of aerial vector. Okay. So here theta represents, I'm repeating it again, make a note of it. Theta is the angle between magnetic dipole moment and the magnetic field. First point. Theta is the angle between magnetic dipole and the, sorry, moment and the magnetic field. Second point. Magnetic dipole moment is always in the direction of aerial vector. Is always in the direction of aerial vector. Third point. How is aerial vector with respect to a surface? Recollected from the first chapter, Gauss law.
Outwards.
It is radially outward, right? So aerial vector is always perpendicular to the surface. Aerial vector is always perpendicular to the surface. Hence, the angle theta between M vector and B vector is the same as the angle between the normal vector and the magnetic field vector. So these are different languages, actually, but they both mean the same. I'm repeating the last point. The angle between the magnetic dipole moment and the magnetic field vector is the same as the angle between the normal vector and the magnetic field vector. Is this clear? So keeping all these four points in mind, what should I take? Theta is?
30.
I hope no confusion, right? It is only 30 degrees. Don't have this confusion. This conductor will not come. It is always the normal. 30 degrees if I take, then what is the area here?
100
a square. 100 what?
100
into 10 power minus 4 meter square. Substitute everything. Check everything is in terms of SI unit. Substitute it, you will get the answer. So getting the answer is not a big task. You need to be careful with these angles and other parts. Okay.
Sir, how would the question be framed such that we take theta to be as 60 degrees and not 30?
They can frame it like this. The angle made by the magnetic field with the conductor. Okay. See, for example, like this. This is a magnetic field. This you're able, I hope you're able to show it. This is a normal. In this question, this is a normal. This is given as 30 degrees. If the same question they told, the magnetic field is making an angle of 30 degrees with the conductor. So this will be the conductor. Okay. So on the conductor, wherever this magnetic field is intersecting, from that point, you need to draw an imaginary line. Then this would have been 30 degrees, but what are you supposed to consider in that particular question?
30 degrees.
Now you need to consider 60. Are you able to understand? So that is how they frame. So in this question, what is the keyword? The angle, it is a normal, right? So you need to underline these keywords. So normal is a keyword. The coil suspended vertically and the normal of the plane makes an angle 30 degrees with whom? With the direction of magnetic field. So that is why you took the value of theta. At the same question being, the coil is suspended vertically and the coil makes an angle 30 degrees with the direction of uniform magnetic field. Then theta should have been 60 degrees. Okay. So we'll wind up the session. The solenoid problem, you yourself can do it, not a big deal. The answer, the formula is mu naught into n into I. So if you don't get it, in the next class, I'll explain it. So next class, I will start with moving coil galvanometer, and then I will explain you about the cyclotron. Next class, this chapter will be over. Okay. So revise it and be ready. Just wait for a minute. Let me take attendance and you can leave. Okay, you can leave.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
దర్శిని మెసేజ్ చేస్తుందా
ఎవరికి